Belinda presents this unabridged recording of
Dragonkeeper by Carole Wilkinson, read by Caroline Lee. The dedication reads, "For John, who first introduced me to dragons, and Lily, my resident editor and sounding board." Glossary. Cash. A Chinese coin of low value with a square hole in the middle. Cheng. A measure of distance equal to about 2.3 metres. Cinnabar. A bright red mineral whose chemical name is mercuric sulphide. Confucius. A Chinese philosopher who lived around 500 BCE. Five classics. Five Chinese books more than 2,000 years old that formed the basis of knowledge in ancient China. Four spiritual animals. The dragon, the qilin, the red phoenix, and the giant tortoise. The ancient Chinese named four constellations after these animals. Han Dynasty. A period in Chinese history when the emperors all belonged to a particular family. It lasted from 202 BCE to 220 CE. Han foot. A measure of length equal to about 23 centimetres. Jade. A semi-precious stone, also known as nephrite. Its colour varies from green to white. Jin. The measure of weight for gold. Jujube. A name for the fruit known as the Chinese date. Li. A measure of distance equal to about half a kilometre. Mu. A measure of land one pace wide and 240 paces long. Pangolin. An animal with a scaly skin and a long snout that eats ants. Qi. According to traditional Chinese beliefs, qi is the life energy that flows through us and controls the workings of the body. Qilin. A mythical Chinese animal with the body of a deer, tail of an ox, and a single horn. Red phoenix. A mythical Chinese bird that looks a lot like a peacock. Shen. According to traditional Chinese beliefs, Shen is the spiritual energy that drives our mental and spiritual activities. It is sometimes translated as the soul. Shu. A measure of weight equal to about half a gram. Author's note. This story is set in the year 141 BCE, the first year of the long reign of Emperor Wudi. Lung Dancer's words of wisdom were inspired by the Tao Te Ching, an ancient Chinese work written more than 2,500 years ago. The Tao forms the basis of the Chinese philosophy Taoism and encourages people to live a simple, honest life with as little interference with nature as possible. Chapter 1. The Edge of the Empire. Lan scowled at her with the distaste he reserved for rats, spiders, and maggoty meat. The only time he smiled was when he was laughing at her stupidity. A bamboo bowl flew through the air, aimed at the slave girl's head. She ducked out of the way. She was very experienced at dodging flying objects, from inkstones to chicken bones. Her master slumped back onto his bed, exhausted by the effort of throwing the bowl. Feed the beasts, wretch.
Yes, Master Lan, the girl replied. Lan scowled at her with the distaste he reserved for rats, spiders, and maggoty meat. The only time he smiled was when he was laughing at her stupidity.
Don't take all day either.
No, Master Lan.
She slipped out of her master's house as an empty wine jar flew towards the door. It was a bitterly cold day. Snow crunched beneath the slave girl's straw shoes as she hurried towards the animal pens. The sky was the colour of ashes. It looked like it would soon snow again. The slave girl didn't have a name. She didn't know how old she was. She had lived at Huang Ling Palace since her parents had sold her to Lan when she was a small child. The previous summer, Lan had shouted that she was thick-headed for a girl of 10 years. As she could only count to 10, she didn't know how old that made her now. Huang Ling Mountain was a barren hill in a range of many barren hills that marked the western boundary of the Han Empire. Throughout winter, it was waist-deep in snow and blasted by freezing winds. In the summer, the air was so hot it was like breathing in flames. The emperor's father had built a palace in this faraway place so that the world would know how vast his empire was. Unfortunately, it was so far from anywhere that few people ever saw it. The palace was surrounded by a high wall of rammed earth. In the eastern wall was the entrance gate. The emperor's residence occupied more than 3/4 of the palace grounds. The animal pens, the stores, and the servants' houses were squashed together in the remaining quarter. In all the slave girl's time at Huang Ling, there had never been an imperial visit. The palace's graceful halls and sitting rooms, its gardens and pavilions, were always empty. Slaves weren't allowed in the palace. Master Lan said he would beat her if she ever went in there. He went into the palace from time to time, but he always came back angry. He grumbled about the wasted space, the unused bed chambers, the cloth-draped furniture, while he had to sleep in his humble house with one room and a roof that leaked. Compared to the corner of the ox shed, where the slave girl slept on a pile of straw, Master Lan's house was luxurious. There was a rug on the earth floor, and on the wall hung a painting of a dragon on a length of blue silk. The fire burned all through winter, and a clever system of pipes carried the heat to warm his bed. Even the goat had a better home than the slave girl. It wasn't the goat that she was going to feed, though. It wasn't the oxen, mooing sadly in their stalls. It wasn't the pigs or even the chickens. In the farthest corner of the farthest palace in the empire, behind the servants' quarters, at the back of the stables and sheds, there was another animal enclosure. It was a pit in the ground, a dungeon hewn from the raw rock of Huang Ling. The only entrance to this pit was a hinged grate, not made of bamboo like the other animal enclosures, but of bronze. The slave girl wore trousers that were patched on the knees and too short for her, and a threadbare jacket with many mends. These were her only clothes. An icy wind blew across the courtyard and straight through the worn fabric, even at the front where the edges overlapped and wrapped around her. She looked into the pit, but could see nothing in the darkness below. She slid a latch across, lifted the grate, and went down a staircase cut into the rock. The girl shivered, not because of the cold, not because of the darkness,
not because of the smell of stale air that came up to meet her from the dungeon. There was something else that she couldn't put a name to that made her uneasy. The pit always had that effect on her, as if there was something waiting in the darkness, something dangerous and frightening. It wasn't the creatures that lived in the pit that unsettled her. Even though they were big and had sharp teeth and claws, she wasn't afraid of them. They were an unnatural sort of beast, different to the farm animals she cared for, and, as far as she could see, of no use to anyone. They were dragons. It was dark and smelt of urine and rotting straw. It had been a long time since the pit had been cleaned. The girl moved out of the square of pale, banded light beneath the grate and into the darkness. She shuffled forward, wishing she could bring a lamp. Master Lan had forbidden such a waste of lamp oil. Her eyes grew used to the darkness. The patch of light beneath the grate now seemed bright. The dragons slept in the darkest corner of the pit. There were only two of them now. The girl could just remember when there had been four. Lao Ma, the old woman who kept the palace clean, could remember the day the dragons first arrived. She had been no more than a girl herself. Lao Ma said there were a dozen or more of the creatures then. The slave girl wondered what had happened to all the others. The creatures didn't move as she approached. They had never tried to hurt her, but she had a feeling that they were hiding their true nature. The painting of the dragon in Master Lan's house showed a magnificent golden creature, snaking and shimmering among clouds. In the dim light of the pit, it was hard to make out exactly what the two imperial dragons looked like. They certainly weren't magnificent. They looked dull and grey. Their scales did not shimmer. They did not fly. Their long, scaly bodies lay all day, curled up like piles of thick rope in the dirty straw. Master Lan was the Imperial Dragonkeeper. His seal of office hung from his waist by a length of greasy ribbon. It was a rectangle of white jade with characters cut into one end and a carving of a dragon on the other. It was Master Lan's job to feed and care for the Imperial Dragons. The girl was just supposed to feed the farm animals and take care of Master Lan's personal needs, cooking his meals, mending his worn silk robes, keeping his house clean. But the dragon keeper was lazy. As the girl had grown older, he'd given her more and more of his duties. He spent more and more of his days lying on his bed, eating, drinking wine, and complaining. It was the Emperor's fault, he said. The Imperial Dragons really belonged at the Imperial Palace in Chang'an. That's how it had been for thousands of years. A shaman should examine them daily, divining the emperor's future from the dragon's behavior. If the dragons frolicked happily in the pleasure gardens, it was a good sign for the empire. If they sulked and didn't eat, it was a bad omen. Many years ago, one of the dragons had bitten an emperor, the father of the current emperor, when he was a child. He was scared of the beasts. As soon as he came to power, he had sent the dragons as far away as possible, to Huangling Mountain. There wasn't a day went by that Master Lan didn't complain that he should have been at Chang'an. The slave girl put down the bowl of mashed taro and millet she had prepared for the dragons. "Dinner time," she said. One dragon stirred. She could barely make out its shape. It lifted its snout to sniff the food, then turned its head away. "Ungrateful beast," she muttered. The bowl of food she had left that morning was still there, untouched apart from where rats had nibbled around the edge. The slave girl had been feeding the dragons since Master Lan had decided he had bad knees and couldn't climb up and down the dungeon stairs every day. That must have been nearly a year ago. The oxen mooed whenever she went near their shed. The goat wagged its tail when she fed it. Even the chickens fluttered expectantly when she brought them food. The dragons had barely glanced at her in all that time. "I was going to change your straw," she grumbled, "but now you can wait." She picked up the bowl of fresh food. No point in wasting it on such surly beasts. They could finish the morning's mash first. There was a rustle in the straw. A nose poked out. It sniffed the air. Beneath the nose were two large yellow teeth. The nose was followed by a brown head, a fat, furry body, and finally a long tail. The girl's frown turned to a smile. "Is that you, Hua?" It was a large rat. She picked it up and hugged it, holding it up to her face and feeling its soft fur on her cheek. "We'll have a good meal tonight," she told the rat. "I've got taro and millet. If I can steal a little ginger from Master Lan's dinner, it'll be a feast." The rat glanced nervously at the dragons. "Don't worry about them," the girl said. "They won't hurt you." The girl tucked Hua inside her jacket, next to the square of bamboo that hung around her neck. It had a worn character carved on it. Lao Ma had told her she was wearing it the day she arrived at Huangling. The girl didn't know the meaning of the character. She couldn't read, and neither could Lao Ma. She hurried back up the stone steps. The slave girl was cooking her master's evening meal in the servant's kitchen when he crept up behind her, startling her. "I found rat droppings in my bed," the dragon keeper shouted. "I told you to kill that pest."
"I did, Master Lan," the girl said, hoping Hua stayed still inside her jacket.
"Just as you ordered."
"You're lying," her master snarled. "If I ever find it, I'll boil it alive."
He picked up the bowl of lentils that were soaking, ready for the girl's own dinner, and hurled it out into the courtyard. The lentils scattered in the snow. He sniffed the stew.
"If there's no onion in my dinner, you'll get a beating."
The girl hadn't put an onion in her master's stew. There were none left in Lao Ma's food store. The slave girl ran to the gate. Not the big wooden gates with the bronze hinges, which were always locked, but a small gate made of bamboo poles behind the goat shed. Outside the palace walls were the orchard, some stunted apple trees and half-dead cherry trees, the vegetable garden, and the rest of the world. Most of the garden was covered with snow, but there was one corner that the gardener kept clear. Underneath a pile of straw, the girl found a few frost-bitten onion plants sticking out of the soil. She hacked at the frozen earth with her blade, but it was as hard as stone. She cut off the limp leaves and hoped they would provide enough flavour. She sat back on her heels. There was a dark orange blot on the horizon. Somewhere beyond the clouds, the sun was setting. She wondered what she would have been doing right now if she hadn't been sold as a slave. Would she be happy? Would she be sitting in a cozy house with her parents, brothers and sisters? Would she have a full stomach?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.